Hello and welcome to Men in Hoodies, the show for all things sports produced by AHS Tiger Life. Thank you for joining us today. Grab your hoodie and let's start the show. Our first topic today is going to continue to stay on the trend of March Madness. So we're going to start out with our top upset so far. And this March Madness has been filled with top upsets, hasn't it?
Yeah, the top upsets for me, I don't know how much of an upset this actually is, but I'm just going to go with Arkansas over Gonzaga in the Sweet 16 as my top upset. And the reason why is because after Gonzaga beat Memphis in the round of 32, I was pretty much convinced Gonzaga had figured out this problem that they had against physical hard-nosed teams that love to pressure you, that love to get up all in your grill, score in the paint, and just out-athlete you. I thought Gonzaga had finally solved that against Memphis.
Nope.
But it turns out that Arkansas, they came to play. Eric Musselman came out with a great game plan. And ultimately, Gonzaga didn't shoot well. They had a really bad night. And Arkansas just had the better athletes. But that is the top upset for me because I really thought that Gonzaga had finally figured that out.
And that's the thing with March Madness. I mean, if you have a bad night, you're out. Like, that's just how it works. So what about you, Brent?
That's a really good upset. Obviously, one of the better games of the tournament, of course. But I'm going to have to go with St. Peter's over Purdue. St. Peter's were the darlings of the tournament. You could have picked multiple games. They played Kentucky really well. Obviously, they won. They played Murray State. That was also a good game. But Purdue is kind of the line. Second weekend, you've had your moment, kind of. Purdue, surely they'll step up and take care of business. I mean, you have the best center combo in the country of Edie and Williams, and you still find a way to lose. You have one of the best guards in the country in Jaden Ivey, still found a way to lose. And it was a good game. It was 67-64, really, really close game, which is what everybody loves in March Madness. So, yeah, St. Peter's over Purdue is definitely mine. How about you?
It's funny how Eder was able to combat those three stars that Purdue has, which is pretty funny. That's just the tournament, how it works. My top upset was Houston versus Arizona. I think this is a game where a lot of people will just expect a lot from Houston. But what they lost, they should not be here. I mean, they lost Marcus Sasser and Trayvon Mark, like, at the beginning of the season. Those are two of their top three guys on their team.
And they lost both of those guys before Christmas.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. And they're, like, you know, a top five seed. They end up upsetting Benedict Mathurin and a really good guard for Arizona. Just this team was so good. So for Houston to upset that, definitely the best upset in my book, other than St. Peter's, obviously. I mean, who can argue against that? Best team that fell out is what we're going to move to next. Brent, who was the best team that you saw in the field that ultimately did not make it to the Final Four?
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of teams that you could say kind of had disappointing runs. Gonzaga wasn't necessarily disappointing, but they lost earlier than lots of people should. They were the favorite to win. But I would say for me, it would have to be Iowa. Iowa was riding a really, really hot streak, came off winning one of their first Big Ten tournament titles in a very, very long time, if ever had, I can't remember. But they had one of the best players in the country nominated for Player of the Year, Keegan Murray. Riding this really hot streak, winning in one of the toughest conferences to win in the country. And then you get knocked out to a lowly Richmond team who shouldn't have even really been there. They won their conference tournament as like a five seed, won a couple games to get into the tournament. Most people thought that they shouldn't be there. And they just had a really bad game. Richmond took advantage of it and just beat them down the stretch, beat them with good defense and making sure that Keegan Murray didn't get to his spots. And that was probably the most disappointing team of the tournament because I know for me, I had Iowa in my Final Four. So it was a disappointing day for me, but obviously for the Hawkeye fans as well.
Well, I had Baylor as my projected national champion, so I suppose I'm going to have to go with them as my best team that got knocked out, even though they were missing arguably their best guy. At the end of the day, their guard play was still absolutely elite. They played super hard. They were super tough defensively, and Scott Drew is still just an amazing coach. So it's surprising to me that they got knocked out in the round of 32. But North Carolina has proven to be insanely good in this tournament. Armando Bacot should definitely be in the first two All-American teams, in my opinion, for just how well he's done here. late in the season. Shout out to Hubert Davis as well. He's done a fantastic job.
Yeah, I definitely agree. I love North Carolina right now, and then that's what happens. Baylor ran into a hot team, and that was their problem. My thing was Gonzaga. I mean, Gonzaga's team is so stacked. The fact that they were able to fall out to an Arkansas team that had some questions, that's just disappointing for me. So I love their roster. I love how much talent they had, but they unfortunately fell out. Next part of the segment is going to be star of the tournament. Who is the guy that really paid dividends for you?
For me, it's not a player. It's a coach. It's Kelvin Sampson, man.
Okay.
I mean, Jake mentioned it earlier. Lost his two best players before Christmas. I mean, and a lot of people were saying that, you know, Houston was not exactly the team that the computers were saying that they were. They were super highly rated throughout the entire season and lost to Memphis twice. And then people were like, uh-oh, here's Houston starting to get exposed. But then we get to the tournament and they make a run to the Elite Eight, beating the number one seed Arizona. And you just have to commend Kelvin Sampson for that job. So for me, he is the star of the tournament and probably the best coach in the country.
For me, I don't really have to go into much detail about this. If you've watched March Madness at all this season and you've seen the darling run that St. Peter's put on and you've seen the mustache floating through the wind, you know that Doug Adirt is going to be my star of the tournament, and I don't know if I need to do much explaining on that one.
Yeah, that's really good. mine would be Drew Timmy, sticking with the Gonzaga trend. I mean, Drew Timmy averaged like 32 and 15 throughout the first two and three rounds. Like, this guy absolutely popped off, so he's definitely my star. Best game. This is going to be an interesting one. I'll start. My best game was actually from the first four with Rutgers and Notre Dame. This is a game where both of them came in exactly even. I mean, no one really knew who was going to win. I personally had Notre Dame, but that was with, like, no background experience at all. So this was a tight game. Went into double overtime or triple overtime. I don't even remember, but great game overall.
For me, the best game was Gonzaga and Memphis. This was a beautiful basketball game. Both teams played nearly perfect. It was an emotional game. Memphis was up by 10 at the half, and then Drew Timmy comes out and gives perhaps the best individual half that we see from any player in the entire tournament. And Memphis couldn't do anything. They couldn't have done anything better in this game. Gonzaga would just prove to be the better team, the more well-rounded team, and that ultimately won out for them. So, yeah, great game.
And Memphis and Gonzaga. For me, both of those games are really, really good. I'm trying to think of a best game was really hard because there's lots of great moments, great games. But for me, the overall best game that wasn't dictated by refs or anything like that, like the Baylor-North Carolina game might have been, I would say Duke and Texas Tech. That game was just, if you're just a common basketball fan, that's just a great game to watch. Like an offensive and defensive battle like that. Like Duke shot lights out. Texas Tech had great defense. This game just came down to the wire. It was a higher scoring game, 78-73. You have two of the better teams in their fields, like offense and defense in the country, coming at each other. And just on this collision course, you know whoever wins this game is going to have a really good chance to make it to the national championship. Mm-hmm. And Duke ultimately won that game, but not before getting a really good fight from Texas Tech. So that's my best game.
Yeah, for sure. Run through this last one quickly. We've got the best future. Best team that may be falling out, maybe still in, that has the best future going forward.
It's definitely Seton Hall for me. They just got Shaheen Holloway, hired him from St. Peter's, and we saw how good of a coach he was in this tournament. So I'm confident that the former Seton Hall point guard is going to be able to get the Pirates back to where they need to be.
Yeah, and that's obviously he has a great story, and we're happy for him at Seton Hall, and he's pretty much destined to do great things with the story that he has there. But for me, the promising future is going to be mid-majors. We saw a step up in the amount of bids that mid-majors got this year compared to past years, with the Mountain West getting four bids. Even though they went 0-4 in the tournament, it's still a step up from what we've seen in the past. So starting to kind of level out the field between the power conferences and the mid-majors kind of gives them a bright future, in my opinion.
Yeah, definitely. Both those are right on point. Mine's going to be Iowa State. Just hired a new coach, and then they pulled in a bunch of transfers and turned that into a tournament-level team. I mean, they were at the top of the Big 12 for a while there until they hit a rough stretch. I'm definitely going Iowa State and the Cyclones there.
Yeah. And coming up next here on the Men in Hoodies, we know all about the popularity of the football and basketball teams here at Arlington High School, but it's actually the Arlington baseball program that has established itself as the pride of Tiger Athletics. With a mark of 8-4, 16 days into the season, the Tigers are a young and vibrant group that hopes to capitalize on their potential as we approach the month of April. With that being said, however, this is still a team that is led by its veteran leadership and senior experience. We spoke with one of those seniors and pitcher Connor McCaslin, along with the head coach of Arlington Tiger Baseball, Brad Smith.
Because we're able to sit there and see quality arms every day, whereas when I was at TRA, we may be one of those teams that somebody may throw a number four or a number five pitcher against at the end of the week because they wanted to save their arm for somebody else type deal. So the quality of pitching that we see thrown at us is at a high level. And I think it's going to get our kids ready. It has no chance but to get our kids ready for the month of May.
Alongside Evan Fargo and Jason Rangel, this is Roman Cleary reporting for AHS Tiger Life.
What's up? And we're going to mix it up a little bit, all right? We're going to talk about Olympic sports that should be in that are not at the moment. Just a little quick segment. So, Roman, if you had one sport you had to pick to be in, what would it be?
Come on, we got to go with 7-on-7 football. I'm just saying, I understand that the Olympics are supposed to be like an international thing, but American football is one of the premier sports in the entire world at this point. So I feel like if you do like 7-on-7, you know, two-hand touch football in the Olympics, I don't think it would hurt. I really don't.
That's good.
Two-hand touch.
What about you, Chris?
Well, I didn't know we were going with like our favorite sports because I already know what you're going to say. So I'm going to go ahead and go with mine. I'm going to say I think we can make cross country an Olympic sport. And explaining it a little, you have like prelims or whatever in your specific countries. And then the top seven runners that come out of your prelims from your country represent the USA in a national cross country like event or whatever, something like that. Something like kind of like you do a track, only it's obviously not track. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's mine, cross
that's
country.
Good. Yeah, I think it'd be hard for that, especially because you have to run on a different terrain than you've ever run on before. I know ground is kind of different. I don't know if that would affect anything. But for me, mine's got to be disc golf. This sport has been rising ever since COVID started. That's personally when I started playing. And this sport is actually a lot more popular than you would think if you're not familiar with it. So I think they could definitely have a course at whatever country they're doing it in. And, you know, just play. I mean, it'd be fun for sure. So that would be mine.
And now we're going to transition to Jaron White for an update on some of our Arlington sports.
What's going on, guys? Jaron had something come up at the last minute, so I'm going to fill in for him real quick. The Arlington Tiger baseball team is out to a decent start to start the season, sporting an 8-4 record just a little over 2 weeks into it. Some of the starts for the Tigers thus far have been Patrick Maxwell, JT Meharry, Wyatt Guess, Carter McKay, who actually has two home runs on the season. Pitchers Connor May and Connor McCaslin have also been huge for this team. The most recent matchup for the Tigers was an 8-5 victory against Briarcrest on March 29th, as Arlington scored three runs in the first inning and five runs in the third inning to secure the victory. The next contest for the Arlington Tigers is actually tonight at 6:30 on the road against Munford. And that's going to do it for this edition of Arlington Sports Updates. Let's now send it back to the studio.
Up next here on Men in Hoodies, we're now going to get into maybe the craziest NFL offseason that we have ever seen. Blockbuster trades, major signings leaking right, left and right, groundbreaking, record-breaking contracts, extensions, all sorts of stuff to talk about. And we're going to just go with what team won it all, first off, Jake.
What team won it all? Man, I'm going to kind of mix it up, all right? I'm not going to go with what team won it all because I think y'all still mind, but who lost it? The Dallas Cowboys. I'm going to turn it to Stephen A. Smith real quick. You lost Amari Cooper for absolutely nothing. Like, this guy was your main receiver, yes. You didn't know how to utilize him well, but that's a front office and that's a coaching, like, that's a thing that they need to work out within themselves. Dak Prescott's a good quarterback. Like, you could do other things to get Amari Cooper involved. So definitely the Dallas Cowboys. They're always trying to find a way to screw up their top talent.
And switching gears back to who won, but someone who has been predicted to win but losing for many, many years, maybe finally figuring out, I think the Browns finally maybe got on the right foot here. They got Amari Cooper for, like we said, basically nothing. I mean, compared to what they had to give up, it was well worth it. Then they went and got Deshaun Watson, who maybe not has played. Maybe you're skeptical about him. He hasn't played in a year, but he was a good quarterback. He was not a scrub when he played in the league. So it was a very, very good deal for the Browns to bring in someone better than Baker Mayfield and who has proven himself on the field before this moment. So.
Look, it's not the fact that I don't like Deshaun Watson. It's just that I do not trust the Cleveland Browns to properly utilize him.
I agree.
Okay, so my winner is going to be the Las Vegas Raiders. I know that they still got the worst quarterback in the division, but they got maybe the best offensive weapon in the entire league now in Devontae Adams, and maybe the best overall roster in the AFC West. They also got Chandler Jones on the defensive side of the ball. So I really, really like the Raiders to potentially make the playoffs and maybe even win the division for this upcoming season. But also, like, I have to mention the Packers as a loser here as well, because, I mean, man, you sign Aaron Rodgers,
or I guess Aaron Rodgers is a loser here because he knowingly signed a contract that's going to pay him $50 million a season, knowing that it meant getting rid of Devontae Adams. So that's just not a great football move there for Aaron Rodgers, but I digress. We're now going to get into our most underrated signing, most underrated acquisition of this free agency period. Brent, what do you got?
I'm going to stick with the Browns train. The Browns train I'm starting to form here, and I'm going to say Amari Cooper. I mean, like we said, basically got him for nothing. He was one of the best receivers on his team, besides maybe CeeDee Lamb when he was healthy.
Oh, he's way better than CeeDee.
But CeeDee Lamb is younger, so he has the upside. So I would say that Amari Cooper going to the Browns when they no longer have Jarvis Landry, they no longer have Odell Beckham, it is going to be the main weapon, and it's going to be few and far between for him next to their second leading wide receiver. So I think he's going to get a lot of reps, lots of fantasy potential if you play fantasy. Also, he's going to have a chance to win. Mm-hmm. Potentially, exactly. And win more games than he's used to, probably. So I'm going to say Amari Cooper as my underrated signing.
Yeah, I'm going Matt Ryan. This is one that a lot of people aren't talking about, but this Colts team was on the cusp of making the playoffs last year. I think they lost to, like, the Jaguars or something like that at the last game of the season, which would have put them in. So I'm definitely going to go Colts. This team is good, and then you add Matt Ryan, who has had – I'm a Falcons fan, so this hurts to say, but he has had a lack of weapons while he's been here. He's had Julio Jones, who's hurt half the season, and then Cordarrelle Patterson. Like, that's all he's got. So I'm definitely going Matt Ryan for this one.
I'm going to go with my team, the Pittsburgh Steelers, for the most underrated signing of the free agency period, and that's Miles Jack. Got him from the Jacksonville Jaguars. Prior to last season, Miles Jack was one of the better linebackers in the league. Tenacious tackler, great cover man, but unfortunately, due to the chaos of Urban Meyer, Miles Jack had a down season in Jacksonville, so the Steelers were able to get him pretty easily. But, yeah, I really like him to come in and be the replacement Mike linebacker for this defense that they've desperately needed since Ryan Shazier got hurt. Yeah, I'm really excited that the Steelers got Miles Jack. So, okay. Yeah, that's my most underrated signing. Yeah. So that was our talk for the NFL free agency period. Now we're going to get into our final four predictions here.
Okay.
To end off the episode, we're going to start out with Villanova in Kansas. First game up Saturday, 5:09 p.m. Central Time. Kansas is favored by 4.5. Jake, who do you got in this one?
I've been high on Villanova all year, but this Kansas team just has something. They've got experience, but they've also got young guys. They've got really good guys down low, but Ochai Agbaji is the key factor of this team. This guy has led out all year. He's averaging 20 throughout the season, and they have a great coach in Bill Self. Like, I love this team in the Final Four. They were a sleeper team when you're looking at all the one seeds, but I expect this team to beat Villanova.
Yeah, and I think I'm going to have to get on the train with you for Kansas. They've really ramped it together. They were kind of on the line to be a one seed towards the end of the year, but then kind of ramped it up to secure their spot along with some other teams losing. People didn't know if they were going to be the strong one seed, the weak one. They really proved themselves. They've had a good tournament thus far, going to play a very good Villanova team, a very strong Villanova team. I think they'll get it done. I think they'll play in the national championship, and the Jayhawk fans will finally be happy again.
I'm a big fan of Villanova's. I think Jay Wright's a fantastic coach, but I do have to go with Kansas in this game because Justin Moore, Villanova's second-leading scorer, did tear his Achilles late in Villanova's Elite Eight victory against Houston. So I do think Kansas is a great team. I would pick Villanova if they were completely healthy, but I do like Bill Self and the Kansas Jayhawks to get that done. And now our second of the doubleheader in the Final Four, the big rivalry, number 2 seed Duke against number 8 seed North Carolina, 7:49 Central. Duke favored by 4. Brent, who do you got?
Well, I think this game is just what makes college basketball so beautiful. I mean, how could you have predicted that it would be UNC and Duke meeting in the Final Four in Coach K's last season of his career? Like, we thought that the last time Duke and North Carolina would meet was when they played in the at the end of the ACC regular season, and they meet once again here on this big stage, the first time they've ever met in their school's history in the tournament. So this is a very huge game, not only for Duke and North Carolina fans, but obviously for Coach K, as it could be potentially his last game. I do think that it's very hard for me, but I do think that Duke will make it to the NCAA Tournament Championship, beat North Carolina in what's probably going to end up being the best game of the tournament. Both teams playing extremely well, but I think that destiny meets North Carolina's strong play and gets the job done.
Okay. I'm going against it. I don't think Coach K is going to be clutch. He wasn't in his last regular season game at Cameron Indoor, but I'm going to have to go to North Carolina in this game. I love how hot they've been. They have not lost, like, recently at all, other than the ACC tournament. I got to go North Carolina to end Coach K's dreamy run at the end.
Can I be honest with the two of you for just 1 second? I'm actually just deciding who's going to win this game, like, right here and right now as we are recording this.
Yeah. But
I'm going to go with Duke to make the national championship, defeat North Carolina. Duke has become a tougher team throughout this NCAA tournament. I think the first loss of North Carolina in the regular season finale really made them have to do some self-discovery about themselves. I really feel like Duke has just become better for it since that loss. And obviously, I'm all for the destiny thing with Coach K. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we're going to get into it. National championship now. Duke and Kansas for me and Brent, and Kansas, North Carolina for Jake. Jake, who do you got in your national championship matchup?
See, an 8 seed has never won the tournament. There was Butler a couple years ago. Fell short. Forgot who it was too, but they fell short. I'm going to have to go with Kansas here. I think Kansas's consistency, I think their roster is going to end North Carolina's run. But I do not think Coach K will get there. But I think Kansas ultimately takes away the championship.
Yeah, and I think that if you get to Destiny, you get over the hump of beating your biggest rival in college basketball, one of the biggest rivalries in sports in general. I think if you can get over that hump and win that game, you're pretty much going to win the national championship. I'm not just going to say that if they win, then they automatically win the national championship, because obviously Kansas is going to give them a fight. But I think Duke meets Destiny in the national championship again, and Coach K goes out on top with his 5th national championship.
I'm going to ditto that in the famous words of Brent Lyons. I'm going to go with Duke to defeat Kansas in the championship game. I think Coach K walks out on top and wins his 6th national title.
And that's going to wrap it up here on Men in Hoodies. Thank you for watching the 3rd episode of our show. We'll see you guys next time.